What's up, everyone? Welcome to the Student Built Startups Podcast, episode 18. I'm your host, Cameron Stone, entrepreneur and marketing analytics student at UMD. I interview student entrepreneurs to share their stories and business strategies. Today's guest is going to speak about how to master marketing with self-development and mindset. He has plenty of experience in this arena, from running over $3.5 million US dollars on social media ads for other businesses and his own personal brands. He'll be sharing his story and how his education has played a role in it. I encourage you to go check out Arsalan UK on Instagram to find out more about him. I'm super excited to introduce you all to the owner of AKM Media, Arsalan Khan. Hey Arsalan, happy to have you here on the Student Built Startups Podcast. Super, super excited to talk to you. I'll have you start off by saying hello to everyone and sharing one crazy but true fact about yourself with the audience.
Awesome. First of all, a pleasure to be on. It's great to be on this podcast to share my voice with potential listeners. One true crazy fact about myself. Well, I broke the quarantine laws. I went outside. I would say one crazy fact is that people assume that I am born and raised in London when I've got a very exotic background. I'm half Russian, half Pakistani, and I was raised in Dubai.
Oh, wow.
So a lot of people never expect that about me. So it's one, I guess, crazy fact about myself.
Yeah, that is pretty crazy. It sounds like very diverse background. I wouldn't have guessed it in our little pre-chat, pre-interview chat. Yeah, that's cool. So yeah, I'll have you start off with sharing a little bit with the audience about your education and entrepreneurial story, including some details about your business, AKM Media.
Awesome. Well, happy to do so. So my company, AKM Media, is basically a social media marketing agency. We predominantly work with people in the e-commerce or info product niches, so like online courses or any business that sells anything online. And we do the Facebook ads, Instagram ads, and Google ads for them. So that's predominantly what my agency focuses on. And the way I started that is actually a little bit of a blur. It's a little bit of a crazy story. So when I first started my business, it happened when I was in university, as I mentioned to you in a chat before. And I was actually sitting at my computer at 5 a.m. in the morning, 4 a.m. in the morning. And this wasn't me waking up at 4 or 5 a.m. in the morning. This was me still awake from the previous night. And I was just looking through videos, you know, ending up on the dark side of YouTube, looking at cat videos suddenly. And then out of nowhere, I saw a video saying how I made $20,000 in a month doing marketing. And I was like, wow, that sounds cool. And just to give you guys like a little bit of brief introduction on my background. So I always had like an entrepreneurial sort of spirit. Before my agency, I had like a Facebook, FBA by Amazon business that I was trying out. Before that, I had a graphics business that I was doing just to avoid working in like a corner store, or to avoid working in Sainsbury's and Tesco's, which I think the American equivalent is like Walmart.
Okay. Yeah.
As like when I was 16, 17, 18, I was like, no, I want to make money on my own somehow. So I always had that spirit. And when I saw this video, I was like, wow, okay, let me try this. But the issue was I was always giving up on things.
Mm-hmm.
So I was kind of like trying something, giving up, trying something, giving up. And it was never consistent or successful because of that. And I didn't have an education in marketing. So a lot of people might think, oh, he went to university for marketing, etc. Nope, I went to university for a biomedical science degree, which is completely unrelated. And then when I saw that video, I checked it out and I was like, wow, if he can do this, what's stopping me from making $20,000 a month doing the same thing? And I just kind of went off what he was already doing. And I did a little bit of research, YouTube videos, a little bit of online courses here and there, even though I didn't have much money to begin with. And then I just started taking action on that knowledge. And then, you know, 2.5, 3 years later, here we are.
Yeah, that's a pretty cool story. It's crazy how just you ended up at 4 or 5 a.m. on the dark side of the internet on YouTube or whatever, and you see a video and it just kind of makes something click and you're like, well, I'm going to try this.
Yeah.
And it turns out that that's the thing that maybe you're really passionate about and or that you find yourself you're really good at or interested in, and that takes you down a path that maybe you wouldn't have if you weren't on that site at that time. So it's kind of crazy to just think like that. But that's cool. So when did you determine that like entrepreneurship was the path you wanted to take? I know you talked about it briefly, but was there like something specific that led to that?
That's a great question. I was literally talking about this with one of my friends a few hours earlier. It was when I was 16, I was working a part-time job at this place called Macro. It was like a night shift job where all I would do, I would put like stock onto the shelves. And that was the only thing I did. I would do like 5-6 hours of that and I'll go home and I would do that like twice a week. Mm-hmm. And it was my first ever like part-time job because I wanted to make money for myself. And as I was doing something, I remember I wasn't following the company protocol to do it. I was doing it in my way because one, it was just decreasing the time it would take to do the job, but I still had the same result. And I remember a manager came up to me and he was like, no, you have to do it this way. And I argued with him. I said, but why? Because I'm doing the exact same thing that you've asked me to do, but I'm doing it in 2 hours less of a time span than it would take. And he was like, that's just the company policy. You have to follow the rules. And at that point, I just felt this anger inside of me. And I was like, I just knew I could not work for somebody else when they had that kind of unlogical thinking behind their reasons. And yeah, after that, I was like, that's it. I need to make my own money. I got to find a way. And as I said, I tried those different businesses. I had a graphics agency. Then I had the FBA with Amazon that I was trying. And then eventually I had my agency, which I finally didn't give up on.
Yeah. No, that's really funny that you say that. That's kind of like what led you down that path. Because I remember when I was like a sophomore in high school, I got my first job at Target here in the US and Minnesota and had a very similar sort of experience. I was always looking for ways to do things more efficiently and find better ways to do things. And the manager would always be like, you got to do it this way. And same sort of thing happened. Right. So
it never made sense either.
It didn't. And it made it tough to go in there and like, I could do this faster, but I can't because they don't want me to. So
I think a lot of people listening will probably relate to that as well.
Absolutely. Yeah. So what did you do to like learn how to start a successful business? I know you said you took some courses and that sort of stuff. But I'm sure there's multiple other things that you've done along with that. So,
yeah. So like, I would consider my agency, my marketing agency to be like my first big success. And the way I feel like I learned how to kind of cope with all of the things that came with that was just trial and error, to be honest with you. I've been speaking to a lot of my students that teach on a one-to-one basis sometimes. And I say to them, you know, you can read any book, you can buy any course, but no book, no course is going to cover everything or every single situation that you might be faced against. And that when you come across those situations and there's no template for it, that's when you either make it or break it as a business owner, because you can either use it as initiative to be like, okay, I'm going to use my brain power here and use the knowledge that I have read about and the courses I've read about and apply it to this situation somehow, whether that's adding something new or doing that, or I can just give up and not find a solution. So it was a lot of trial and error. There were situations that I came up against where I was like, well, this was not in the course. Oh, this wasn't in the book I read. This wasn't in any book I read. it was a lot of those moments, and it ultimately came down to, you know, sitting down and not letting the stress and pressure of the situation get to me, and instead focusing on how can I find a solution to this, because that's all any business really is. It's just it's a solution to a problem.
Yeah, definitely. I really liked what you said there about if you have a problem and you didn't learn about it in a course, or you didn't read it in a book, that's like what really being an entrepreneur is taking the knowledge that you learned and applying it to something that not that specific situation. If you can overcome challenges through adapting your knowledge to different situations and learning through experience, that's kind of what separates some of the successful people versus the people who give up, I think personally is.
100%. I think it's being able to bridge that gap with your own initiative.
So what's your favorite thing that you do in your day-to-day business activities?
My favorite thing? I'm going to say it's probably, it sounds a bit cliche, but just waking up. Like just waking up and like getting ready for the day. Like, so today I was actually filming a day in the life of an entrepreneur video for my YouTube, because I'm trying to kickstart that again.
All right.
So like when I was in the morning, when I woke up, I had to physically wake up first And then I had to get the camera out and then pretend I was waking up again. and then for a moment, I was like, what am I doing? But it's just little things like that. I think my favorite part is just – my favorite part of any day in my business activities is just kind of the knowing that I'm going to be learning something new or that I'm contributing to something in a way that I may not even directly know about. You know, a lot of the work that we do for our clients, it affects their lives in a massive way. Because it makes them more money, and that money helps provide towards the further investments or to their family or to their lifestyle. And I think when you have everything automated, you kind of forget that. So it's that daily sort of reminding myself that, you know, like I'm making an effect on people's lives, and it's a big responsibility to have. So I need to make sure I'm at like my top form and continuously do that. So I wouldn't say I have like a set. I know your question was, what's my favorite business activity, but I wouldn't say I have like a set favorite thing, just because my day is so fluid and I don't have like a strict every day I'm doing this for 2 hours. I have some things that I do, but I wouldn't say like they're my favorite things to do. It's just more like the things that you have to be disciplined enough to do. Otherwise your business will fall apart.
Yeah, no, I really liked what you said about just the making impact on other people's, whether that's just their lives or their business, because having that fulfillment is one of the absolute just greatest things I think about entrepreneurship, because you have such a huge opportunity to help others and make an impact. So when it comes to business, what are your top three priorities?
That's a great question. I'm going to say top three would have to be focusing on building meaningful relationships as the absolute number one. Number two would probably be, does it fulfill me? And number three would be, is this really worth doing?
Mm-hmm. All right.
So I think when it comes to any decision I make in my business, those are my top three things. Like, so when it comes to, for example, signing a new client or potential new client, I do look at those things like, one, can I build a meaningful relationship with this business or this business owner that's going to mean something to me and them long term? Because I'm no longer in the business of caring about the short term paycheck for a month or 2 months or 3 months. You know, I want clients that I'm going to be with for years to come, for 5 years down the line. And then two, what was my second point?
meaningful relationships. I know one was, is it worth it to me? And then does it fulfill me? I'm pretty sure that's what it was.
Yeah. And of course, like if it doesn't fulfill me, then what's the point anyway?
Yeah.
And the third point of like, does this mean something to me is, you know, like if I'm working with somebody or if I'm about to do an action, am I really passionate about this or am I just doing it because I'm in autopilot mode and I'm just doing it for the sake of doing it? And it's interesting, like when you break down your daily life, for a lot of people, they'll notice that for number three, that third point on is this worth doing? They'll realize that it's not worth doing, but they're just doing it because they're so habituated to doing it on a daily basis and it's ingrained into them. So I always try to avoid doing things just because it's ingrained into me.
Yeah, no, that's a really great point that you made there. So when you first started your business, either like you're one of your first businesses that you tried starting or AKM Media, what was like your biggest fear that you had and how did you overcome that?
Oh, so this has got a very deep, interesting story around it. So when I first started my business, it was a fear that I didn't even realize I had until I actually spoke to one of my clients about it. And I'll explain that in a moment. So as I was growing my business and as my agency was, because my agency blew up really, really quickly just because I put the systems in place from an early point into the business. Mm-hmm. So because those systems were there, there was no kind of things for it to fail on and everything was already set up to work optimally. And because it scaled so quickly, a lot of the time I didn't have time to really sit back and realize like what's going on here, like really understand the depth of how much I had scaled, because I had grown from going from, you know, zero in my bank account to over six figures in less than 6 months. And that was insane to me because I was 21. And, you know, at the time, as it was happening, I wasn't thinking much about it. But once I saw that number in there, like a whole six figures in my bank account within 6 months, that's when it really dawned on me, like, this is real. And I could lose this at any moment which made no sense. It was like an irrational fear that because I had the systems in place to make sure I couldn't lose it at any moment, but it was still scary to think that I could lose it. And I think I got into this like cycle without realizing, but subconsciously fearing losing my business somehow and having like a negative connotation towards it. So the more success I got, the more fearful I became. And I didn't actually realize this until I went to Los Angeles in November, one of my clients there, he's like a world renowned subconscious reprogramming expert, and he has courses on that. And I went out to see one of his live events. And when I was at his live event, they were breaking down like how to bring out the negative within your subconscious and eliminate it for good. And as we were doing this, I realized I had this anxiety and fear around losing my business somehow, like out of thin air. And it was really irrational, but it was there and it was kind of taking over my subconscious thoughts. And that's when using his techniques on bringing it out, I became self-aware that it was there. And once I was self-aware, because I'm a very pragmatic person, I realized that, you know, there's no need for me to have these thoughts. And within the span of like a week or two, I did his exercises on eliminating how to eliminate it from your subconscious, how to do the exercises before bed and in the morning, because that's when you're in alpha state mm-hmm. and you're in theta state. And that's when your subconscious is most open to suggestion. And then within 2 weeks, I noticed that, you know, all those thoughts had gone. And yeah, so that's literally how I overcame them.
Well, that's a really interesting kind of story there, because I think a lot of other people can actually relate to that. As they become more successful, they have more fear about losing what they've gained traction on. I think that might be something to do with like when you're first starting out, you don't really have anything to lose and you're just grinding, trying to build something. And if you fail, you fail and you don't really lose anything. But once you build something and you're like have something there, if like that fear of like losing that is kind of real and you haven't really maybe had that before, especially for like new entrepreneurs, I could see that definitely being something other people could relate with.
I hope so. I think the main takeaway for it is just to, no, I think the best thing that you can do as a human on a daily basis is just to really look into yourself and your thoughts and catch yourself out on those negative things. And the more you catch yourself out, the more you become self-aware to them, and then it naturally just fades away. So I think that's like the best advice I can give to like how to overcome that.
Yeah, that's a really good tip there. So switching to a little bit of a different topic here, are you more focused on creating like your personal brand, or is building a business brand something that you are more focused on?
Interesting question. I would say it's a good mix between both. I would say that if you asked me maybe 6 months ago, I would have said just branding the business. Mm-hmm. In the last 6 months, I've started to pivot that focus to personal brand as well. Like I said, I'm doing the YouTube now and starting that up and trying to be as like high quality as possible I can with my content, just to appeal to the masses. But at the same time, I'm actually in the works of starting a new e-commerce brand. So I'm going to be focusing on branding my business in that sense as well, and continuously branding my agency through paid ads to get new clientele on board and things like that. So I would say it's a good mix, but I enjoy the personal brand, the branding a lot more.
Yeah, I can relate to that, because I've started a couple small businesses in the past that haven't really worked out. And I haven't ever focused on personal branding at all before I started the podcast. And I can relate that personal branding, because I see the podcast as maybe building a brand a little bit about the Student Built Startups podcast itself, but really just building the personal brand is something that I've kind of grown to love.
It becomes a fun thing to do too.
Yeah, it does. It does. So in our pre-interview chat, you mentioned that you've ran over 3 million in ads over the last 1.5 years. So I'm sure you have some really helpful tips and cool things that you could share. So if you had 5 things that you could share, what are the 5 most important things about running ads on social media?
Okay. So I would say the first thing is forget everything you know about traditional ads. what I've noticed is a lot of these businesses that come to me or that we sign on as clients for the agency, what they think of paid ads is completely the opposite of what paid ads is and how it functions. So a lot of the time, these business owners, they still have this perception, and I wouldn't even say business owners, I would just say like a typical person has this perception that ads is still like traditional media, where it's like, oh, you post up a banner ad and then people see the banner and they click it and then that just means you get a sale or something like that, right? And then it's not trackable, and then people don't even understand the whole tracking side of things. Mm-hmm. So the back end and how, you know, the pixels are optimized with Google, with Facebook, with Instagram, how you can do lookalike audiences, you can use email lists and current data that you have to make even more, you can use videos, retarget, you know, like it's a whole new world to people. So first thing, forget everything you know. Second thing, I think, is be very granular with how you do ads for your business or for yourself. A lot of people go into things and they're very, very broad because a lot of the time they're a little bit scared to niche down into the target, the more narrow and targeted ads on social media. So second thing is just like be a little bit more granular. And what I mean by granular is don't be afraid to test out 10 different ad sets, each one with a separate interest, for example. What I see a lot of new people when it comes to ads is they put one ad set. And an ad set is something you'd find in Facebook ads or Google ads for those who are not familiar. And it's where you do all your targeting as to who you're going to be targeting and the interest and age groups, etc. A lot of the time people just bunch up a lot of like-minded interests into one ad set and they'll release that. And that's great. It can get the results. It cannot as well. But if you want to be more effective, what I recommend is just be as granular as possible from the beginning. So if you've got 10 interests in mind, do a separate ad set for each interest, and then you can very specifically see what is working and what's not working. And then it's a lot easier to then scale up from those things. Because the goal of ads, regardless, is going to be going from a broader perspective to a narrower one. That's the end goal. So if you start very, very broad, you're going to have to spend more time narrowing down and more money narrowing down. Or you could start out a little bit broad, but still have that granularity and be a little bit more narrow. And then it will just make it a lot more streamlined and you'll end up spending less money and wasting it. That's my second tip.
All right.
Third tip is don't let the numbers get to you. And I think this is from personal experience. Sometimes when you have very high budget ads, and if people who do e-commerce, they'll know, like, I know there's 16-year-olds out there who are spending hundreds of thousands on ads. You know, it's a thing now in our world. Just because you can get such crazy amounts of cash flow so quickly now, mm-hmm. with the right ads and the right products. So don't let the numbers get to you. And, you know, just because you're spending a lot of money and it's working doesn't mean that the next day it might suddenly still be the same. It can change instantly in terms of the social space. I've had ad sets for clients which are getting like 10 times the return on ad spend, go from 10 to like 2 overnight, right? No reason for it except for the algorithm changes. Facebook starts showing your ad to other people within those interests, and then suddenly you have no control over it. Because at the end of the day, they're a business. They want to make money too. So the more they can get you to waste, the better it is for them. So don't let the numbers get to you. Number three, I think, is expect the unexpected, right? That goes, it goes directly into the next one, where it's like you can never be certain on what's going to happen. So I think one thing I always say to new clients is, if you can find me a marketer that tells you that they can guarantee you that this will happen, I can hands down tell you right now they're full of it. But like they're chatting, you know, they're speaking from the ass, basically.
Yeah.
Because no marketer, no matter how good you are in the industry, no matter what kind of results you get, can predict what's going to happen in ads in a week from now, because it could completely change. And it happens all the time. We see it happen all the time in the industry. So expect the unexpected and never kind of think that just because you found one thing that's working, that it's going to be working in a week or in a month or in 6 months. It's guaranteed to change. So that's point number three or four, I think it was.
Four, I think. Yep.
Four. And I think my last point would just be to start small. Start small and take your time with things. A lot of new people, when they come into the industry, they rush into thinking they found the winning thing on ads, the winning targeting audience or the demographic, and they rush into it and they put a lot of their money to scale it really quickly. What I recommend to new people and businesses in general is just to start small, make sure it's proven to be working in that demographic, in the targeting you're doing, and then slowly increase it in increments. You know, I've seen some crazy stories where people have gone from spending $20 a day to $2,000 in a day. And then what happens is the $20 a day is working, but they suddenly switch to $2,000 a day, and 60% of conversions have been lost. Right. And they've wasted like a good, like 1,300 for nothing.
Yeah.
So kind of increase everything in small increments and just watch the numbers, watch the data, because the data doesn't lie.
Absolutely. That is one thing that I'm very passionate about, is the data does not lie. Just to hammer that in for everyone listening, the five tips were: forget everything you already know about ads. Make sure to be granular and test new things when you're starting out. Don't let the numbers get to you, because things can change fast. Make sure to expect the unexpected and start small. Well, we're about halfway through the episode, so we're going to take a moment for a brief advertisement. Over the past few months, podcasting is something that I've become very passionate about. It's helped me open many doors to new relationships, new networking opportunities, and giving the opportunity to share other people's knowledge and grow my personal brand, as well as have a lot of fun. Whether you're looking for a new marketing channel, have a message you want to share with the world, or just think it would be fun to have your own talk show, podcasting is an easy, inexpensive, and fun way to expand your reach online. Buzzsprout is hands down the easiest and best way to launch, promote, and track your podcast. Your show can be online and listed in all the major podcast directories like Apple Podcasts, Spotify, Google Podcasts, and more within minutes of finishing your recording. Now, I have a special offer for all of the listeners here on the Student Built Startups podcast. Following the link in the show notes lets Buzzsprout know we sent you, gets you a $20 Amazon gift card if you sign up for a paid plan, and helps support our show. Podcasting isn't hard when you have the right partners, and the team at Buzzsprout is passionate about helping you succeed. Join over 100,000 podcasters already using Buzzsprout to get their message out to the world. The link is in the show notes. So if somebody has not ever ran any ads before and they just want to take their first step to running ads for their business, what would you say that first step should be?
Understand your market. I think that's the best thing. Understand who you're doing ads for. Understand it from their point of view. And I think this is where a lot of agencies fall short on when they do ads for businesses. I think a lot of people these days, you know, they have one person in the business and they're like, oh, I have an agency. Or they have two people, they have themselves and a virtual assistant who's halfway across the world, and suddenly they're an agency. To me, an agency is when you're a full-fledged team of permanent staff and you have at least 3-4 people on your team and you're producing consistent results. That's, to me, that's an agency. So when it comes to starting ads, a lot of people, they just jump the gun and they think, okay, we're just gonna start running ads because, you know, this kind of is what your customers would be interested in. But they never think about, okay, this is what the customer's interested in. This is how they would feel if they saw these ads. Why would they feel that? When they go to the landing page after the ads, how would they feel then? Is it congruent, right? Is there a natural flow, an ebb and flow to the things that we're doing? Because ads are just the front end. Like, to be a good marketer, you have to have everything from A to Z set out, so then it makes sense to the customer to then buy into your service, into your product, into your subscription, whatever it might be. It needs to make sense from start to the end. And a lot of people who start ads out, whether it's a business or somebody looking to do it on their own, they kind of just do what is logically making sense, and they forget to think emotionally what makes sense. Because at the end of the day, people act on and buy on emotion. They don't buy on what makes logical sense.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, no, that's a really, really great tip there. You made a good point how, as a marketer and running ads, it's important to understand your market and also understand kind of that your goal isn't necessarily to have your ads perform well, but to have the ads perform well so you can get customers to the website and make sure that that's congruent with the ads and lead to a purchase in the end. So when is a time that a business should run ads? And then is there a time that maybe a business shouldn't run ads? Is there?
Good question. Always run ads. Run ads day and night, especially during this unprecedented times that we're going through right now. I think when things are good, do marketing. When things are bad, definitely do marketing, like 100%. Of course, it doesn't make sense if you're like a business that's encouraging people to get together and things like that during these times. In that case, you know, there's a few minor exceptions to that rule, But other than that, I think a business should always be marketing themselves in the best form possible. And these days, that just happens to be through paid traffic on ads on Google, on search engines, etc.
All right, cool. Thanks for sharing that. I was pretty sure that's what you were going to say, but just wanted to make sure.
Always. Keep spending your money.
Yeah. So what are some of the most common advertising mistakes that you've made or that you've seen others make?
Well, yeah, I think that's a good question again. I think it definitely ties back into the five things I said.
Mm-hmm.
The mistake of, you know, scaling too quickly and not starting small. The second thing being about how people don't understand their market fully. They just kind of go off what makes logical sense. So, you know, I'm doing ads for a gym, which means, you know, fitness, health, I'm going to put all those interests in there, but they don't think about the other things like maybe behavioral traits that a person who'd be looking to get into or the demographic of the age that would be best represented and things like that. So being very granular again with your approach. And number three is actually caring about the customer experience. Mm-hmm. I think there's a bigger lack of that in the industry right now. And it's something that I'm quite passionate about because you get a lot of, these gurus now, you know, self-proclaimed gurus who are helping and making courses on how to market, how to do Facebook ads, but they're just, you can very quickly tell when you take the courses that they teach you just how to make very quick cash, but not how to sustain that success.
Mm-hmm.
And I think it's when you start really caring about building those relationships and caring about the customer experience, that's when you stand out to a business owner, or that's when your ads stand out to the rest of the market. And it goes a long way just thinking like that.
Yeah, yeah, for sure. Those are some very common mistakes that I've heard of from some other people as well. And like focusing on the long term is something that I think everybody should do, because if you can make quick cash now and get your hands on some money, like what does it matter if 6 months or a year down the road, like you don't have any clients left?
Exactly. Like what good is wealth if you can't have that wealth for a sustained amount of time?
Yeah, absolutely. How does self-development and mindset play a role in entrepreneurship, and what are some things that you do around those topics?
That's a very good question. I think when it comes to self-development and mindset, it's crucial, if not essential, to entrepreneurship. I think it's one thing that makes people who either succeed or fail stand out. The mindset and how they think behind their actions and why they do what they do. You know, I think Simon Sinek, I think.
Yeah.
He made that book on why. Yeah, like, what is your why? And I think when you have that mindset of having that purpose behind your actions and reasons and doing it not just, you know, like I said, for quick cash, but doing it because you genuinely want to impact people's lives, or maybe you want to be the best marketer in the world, right? That's a purpose on its own. Maybe that's a goal of yours, and that's okay. Because it's something to strive to rather than quickly getting cash come into your account and losing it in 2 weeks, like we talked about. So, and then self-development, I think, is another key, because the person I was when I started my business would not be able to make the finances or the investments that I do now. I wouldn't be able to start this e-commerce brand, for example, that I'm very passionate about. So the person that I was then didn't have the mindset or the knowledge to do what I can do now. And, you know, I have crazy ambitious goals and I tell people them all the time, like, you know, I want to make, like, money isn't really the main goal here, but like, you know, it'd be nice to make like $1 million a month or 10 million a month one day, maybe like $1 million a day, even, right? These are some crazy goals that I genuinely have for my, like, the future 5 years and 10 years. And when you tell somebody that, it can sound a bit outlandish, it can sound a little bit crazy, but I'm not excited about the money that I might hit. $1 million a day or $1 million a month, I'm more excited about the person that I would become in order to attain that.
Mm-hmm.
And I think when you focus on your development and bettering yourself, you fall in love with life a little bit. I know it sounds a little bit cheesy and flowerish, I guess, but it's true. Like, I think when you focus on yourself, when you genuinely do it only for you and for the betterment of yourself, you start falling in love with the daily little things. You start feeling really fulfilled on a day-to-day basis. One of the most common problems in the world, for example, is that people think they're not good enough. And mm-hmm. And one of the biggest reasons for that is because they feel like they're not fulfilled. They haven't fulfilled themselves. They need somebody else to do it. They need a job to do it. They need an addiction to do it. And when you start working on yourself and getting rid of those external distractions and realizing that you have everything you need within yourself, that's when you really step up to the next echelon of yourself, in your business, in your relationships, social life, and you start seeing a drastic change in every area of your life that you wouldn't otherwise.
Yeah, you made some awesome points there. One thing that I really want to hammer in was when you said, make sure to understand your why. In my personal experience, I've done some personal training in the past at a gym up here. And when I'm setting goals with clients, I always tell them, first thing, understand why you want to achieve your goal. And then once you think you understand why, ask yourself why you have that why. And just keep going until you like are down to your like soul and like figuring out why like you want to do anything. Just I'm very passionate about like understanding your reasonings behind you, behind why you do stuff.
I'm the same. I think it's super important. And I think we live in a society and generation now where there's not enough people asking that.
Mm-hmm.
And I think it's a thing that needs to change for sure.
Yeah, I agree with you. So we're going to jump into the fast five section to the last part of the interview here. So I'll ask you five quick questions. We'll go through those pretty quick. So what is the most valuable class or course that you have taken?
Oh, that's a great question. Put me on the spot here. There's so many courses I've taken. You know what? I'm going to go for an untraditional answer. I'm not going to say it's a certain class or a course. I would just say it's the first YouTube videos I started watching. I don't even remember the videos, but it's the fact that I took the initiative to start learning about what is social media marketing, what is Facebook ads. I think that's been the most valuable, because if it wasn't for that, I wouldn't be where I am now.
Yeah, it's a great point there. I know YouTube is a great place to start if you want to learn about something and you don't have much knowledge about it. There's a ton of great information out there. Just what is one book that you would recommend?
Ooh, Cybernetics by Dr. Maxwell, I think it is. But it's one of the best books. I would say if I could recommend only one book to a person in the whole life, and that's the only book that I'd ever read, Psycho-Cybernetics is the book that guarantees eternal happiness and success if you follow the practices that it teaches.
All right, awesome. What is one business tool that you would recommend?
I'm gonna say Instagram.
All right,
Instagram is a great tool now for leveraging your business, for even getting new clients. I had a client come in the other day, actually, funnily enough, through an Instagram comment that I left on a meme page. And I was simply leaving a funny, relatable comment just because I was having fun, you know, enjoying my downtime. And a person saw that comment, because I got quite a few likes, came to my Instagram, saw what I was doing, checked out my website, and actually booked in a call because they have a business that they need marketing for. So it's crazy how that translated from a comment on a meme page. But Instagram is an amazing tool, right? Instagram.
That's pretty cool. Cool little story there. You got a client from leaving a comment on a meme page. I like that.
Yeah. The possibilities are endless. Like, if that doesn't explain to you how crazy the platform is, then I don't know what will.
Mm-hmm. So how do you schedule your time and plan things ahead?
Yeah, that's a great question. So I use a thing called the three-step rule. I think it was originally Jeff Bezos that had mentioned it, and how he only sets himself three main tasks that he needs to do a day. But I've just amplified that into other aspects, so not just a day. So I would set myself three major tasks that I would have to do in a day, three major tasks that I would need to do in a week, and three major tasks that I want to accomplish in a month. So thereby, the three major daily tasks contribute to the weekly ones, and the weekly ones contribute to the monthly goal. And I find that when you do that, it just really helps you keep yourself in check as to what you're doing and if you're on target to hit those goals or not.
Yeah, I really like that. Setting short-term goals to help reach your long-term goals is a pretty effective way of doing that. So how do you get focused and stay productive when you have just a ton of stuff on your plate?
This is a great question. This is something that the book actually taught me about.
All right.
So we get wrapped up in, you know, thinking that we have so much to do at all times. But if you remember that ultimately you can only do one thing at a time, and you really understand what that means, that I can only do one thing at a time, you stop worrying about the 12 things you need to do later, because you can only do what you're doing right now. And once you're finished, you're going to do the next thing. and then you're going to do the next thing. And if you start focusing on what you're doing now and stop focusing on the 12, 15 other things I need to do before dinner or before the day ends, you will be more productive. You'll be more into the zone of your work and, you know, hitting those alpha points in the flow states that they talk about. And you won't have that stress or worry because it doesn't add to anything at the end of the day.
Yeah, you made an awesome, that was just, I'm not even going to say anything else about it. That was really good. So make sure to listen to that, everyone. That was something to write down. So we're finished up with the fast five there. You gave some great information about marketing, social media ads, self-development. But before we wrap up, I'll ask you to provide one main takeaway that you want everybody to remember.
I think it would just be the last point I touched on. I think that's a really big thing that people get wrapped up in on a day-to-day basis is just remember that you can only do one thing at a time. You know, if you have 15 things to do, don't worry about how you still have to do another 12 other things. Focus on the thing you're doing now. Finish it. Focus on the next one. Finish it. Focus on the next one. And you'll find that you'll actually get a lot more done that way because you'll stop stressing and feeling that anxiousness of, oh no, I have so much to do. And instead you'll be focusing on what you have to do. And thereby, as a result, you'll get more done.
Absolutely. I think a lot of people spend more time thinking of how they're going to get everything done than actually working on stuff. And once you have that mindset, that flips everything completely. So great main takeaway. Last thing, where can we find more about you and your business?
My Instagram.
Instagram. All right, cool.
Best place to hit me up. It's at Arsalan UK.
Okay, great. I'll put the link in the show notes for that so everybody can check that out there. Really glad to have you on the podcast today.
It was great to be on, man. It was a great podcast. I love the questions you asked.
I'm really glad that I was able to share Arsalan's story with all of you guys. Thanks again for being on the show, Arsalan. And thanks to everyone listening right now. I truly appreciate all of your support on this journey. It would mean the world to me if you could subscribe to our show, give us a rating, and leave us a written review, and maybe share this episode with a friend if you think it's worthwhile for them to listen to. If you're looking for the links to everything that we talked about today, as well as the show notes summarizing everything that we've talked about with all the key points highlighted, make sure to head over to studentbuiltstartups.com/episode-18. Thanks again, and I'll catch you on the next episode.